Professor Sunil Kumar, distinguished guests, advisors for IIT Palghat, TIKIN, the Board of Governors, students, faculty members. Thank you for inviting me again to a key milestone for IIT Palghat. You know, it's quite impressive in a very short period of 5 years. You've actually scaled up the number of students, the number of faculty. You're building a new campus. You are also launching TIKIN today. You know, to create a connect with industry, a better mechanism to connect with industry, and lots of new things that are happening. And so, I'm very glad to be part of this journey. As an outsider, you know, I always think about the experience of building organizations. You know, I have been part of the Infosys journey, and I know what it takes to build an institution. And you are experiencing this. I think the faculty will definitely remember this for the rest of their life, and some of the early students will also remember the experiences. And when I talk to some of the older alumni of IIT Madras, they talk about the early beginnings of IIT Madras, actually. And you are going to see, you know, you're going to experience the same thing here. You know, the first class, the first temporary campus, moving to the new campus, you know, that experience is quite unique. And future students probably will hear stories from you, but they'll have to be satisfied with those stories rather than experience, actually. And this experience will increase your ability, your strength to face difficult challenges in the future. It will help you build institutions like this in the future. So now let me take you through my presentation. I'll talk about you know, why something like TIKIN is very much important. I'll put that in the context of what is happening today. In terms of, you know, initially the crisis the entire world is facing, but beyond that, the opportunity that exists for us in technology and in India. Let me start off by officially launching TIKIN. So we have the official launch here. Thank you, Anuradha, for making this set of slides and letting me do this from my PowerPoint itself. So, you know, TIKIN is officially launched. See, the institute is not just students and faculty. The institute is in the ecosystem that consists of the society, of course. That's, you know, that region, the people of that region, the industry that is there, but industry could be local, could be regional, could be national, could be global. You know, Sunil already mentioned that, you know, he would like to see IIT Palghat be a icon, be a partner to industry globally. Truly, that is how we should think about it. Alumni is a very important part of this ecosystem. You will have the alumni, you know, growing in the future, but you need to start thinking about the alumni from day one itself. As and when students pass out, make sure that you create a mechanism for them to stay engaged with the institute. The students, you know, do research, learn, faculty teach, faculty do research. But you know, in today's world, we need to start thinking about you know, the application of this knowledge for the benefit of society, and you know, the knowledge creation itself is very important, but at different, you know, stages or different time frames in the future, this knowledge will be used by society. You know, some will be used immediately, some will be used in the medium term, maybe some of it will be used in the long term. Typically, you know, an institute will look at some ratio of applied knowledge which will be used in the next 5 years, and basic knowledge which could be used over the long periods of time. Both are equally important for progress in society. Both are important important responsibilities of an institute. An incubator, a institution that is created to augment the activities of the institute, which gives it the freedom to step outside the institute, bring all these stakeholders into a common platform, bring all these stakeholders into the management of this institution, the second institution that I call the incubator, for want of a better name. It could be you know, a society, a trust, a Section 8 company, etc., allows you to actually have a different make of that incubator organization. Now, this is actually accepted by the government. The government, in fact, encourages you to think about one or two institutions on the side of the institute. This is owned by IIT Palghat, but IIT Palghat can set this up different from the Board of Governors. See, that traditionally, the Board of Governors will look at you know, education and research. Yes, today more and more the Board of Governors realize that applied research is important. Working with industry to take this research to market is important. But here is a mechanism that allows the institute to think about this differently. The purpose of the incubator is to create new products, create new businesses that will apply this knowledge and create you know, useful products and businesses for society. You know, I've shown startups here. So this is what you know, IIT Palghat is doing. You know, Professor Sunil Kumar talked about you know, the DST project, Intelligent Collaborative Systems project, that IIT Palghat has won from DST on cyber physical systems, and there it is a requirement that this be housed in a separate entity than the institute. The funding will go to this separate entity, and that entity will be able to not just spend it on you know, activities which are required to create products and services, required to create startups, businesses. It can also actually sanction projects for industry as well as other research efforts that IIT Palghat wants to support. So in fact, this allows you to fund other programs and projects that IIT Palghat can fund. 50% of the funding goes towards external activities. So only 50% can be to industry, the institute activities. 50% is beyond or outside the institute. So these are now mechanisms to ensure that the impact of the activities of the institute can be thought in a much bigger you know, frame of reference, and impact can be in the short term and impact can be thought of as looking to bring new products and new businesses to society. So this is from the institute viewpoint, the need to think about application of the knowledge that is created and a structure in order to make that indeed happen. And that's why I'm very glad that I'm here, as part of this celebration of what the institute has achieved, but also creation of the Technology Innovation Foundation of IIT Palghar. Now, let me look at it from the industry viewpoint. See, traditionally, industries have thought about vertically integrating, creating an organization that is self-sufficient. You look at what is happening inside that organization. But with internet, with ability to collaborate globally, with the ability to work with academic institutions like IIT Palghar, with the ability to work with partners in industry, suddenly you realize, which is always true, but the realization is more today because you have now mechanisms to collaborate, better mechanisms to collaborate. The innovation that is inside an organization, the knowledge that is inside an organization is limited. It's limited by its capability, it's limited by its resources, it's limited by the people. Whereas if you look at the innovation that's outside the organization, the knowledge that's outside the organization, that's actually an order of magnitude. You can think of that as the infinity outside an organization. And the organization's ability to tap in will in the future decide how good this organization will be. Now, I know of several organizations, actually several businesses that have set targets, that have set goals, saying that 50% of our revenue in any year or 30% of our revenue in any year must come from products and services that were introduced in the last 5 years. And out of that, 50% must be sourced from outside the company, which is a very, very, I think, realistic and ambitious target that forces the organizations to go outside to seek innovation and things like that. And this is a very important mechanism for keeping that organization vibrant, dynamic, relevant in today's world. And there are mechanisms, as I said. One of the ways in which you do this is to work with the startup ecosystem around you, with the startup ecosystem in incubators like IIT Palghar is setting, etc. And there are two ways you look at it. One as strategic, where they are adjacent to your business, their products and services are adjacent to your products and services, and you would look at acquiring them once you're comfortable that they're going to be adding value to you, that you can integrate and take it inside your organization. The second is financial, where you want to support that ecosystem, you want to support those startups, you expect financial returns from those investments, but it also gives you a visibility into the innovation that's happening. And some of these financial investments may move to become strategic in the future. So having a plan to work with startups, I think, is extremely important. This is very important from a knowledge acquisition point of view also, because the people who are involved in this learn a lot from working with startups. The way startups work, the way startups today look at the speed of doing something, the way the startups are changing the business processes, the pace at which they work, etc., are all important pieces of knowledge that an organization need to understand and bring it inside. And last but not the least, the innovation outside is typically funded by what is called venture capital, risk funding, etc. Whereas the research that happens inside the organization goes off your P&L, may be capitalized sometime, but it has impact on your profit and loss every single year. And so if the research fails, you take an impact on your profit and loss. Whereas if the research is done outside, majority of that is absorbed by risk funding, and it has no impact on your balance sheet. It has no impact on your P&L. So there are many reasons why this is becoming a very important model for organizations to look at working with the innovation that's happening outside. And if you don't have a program such as this, you're missing a lot. One final point here, if you look at market capitalization of businesses, new businesses get significantly high market cap, right? If you look at the top five companies in the US stock exchange, they're all less than 50-year-old companies. These are Microsoft, Apple, Facebook, Google, or Alphabet, and Amazon, less than 50 years old. If you look at Tesla, their market cap is significantly higher than the top three automotive companies in the US. I think Tesla was set up in 2001 or something like that, right? They've disrupted the automotive industry. If you just look at Zoom, collaborative tool, I think 2008 or something like that was set up. I think, I don't know what is the market cap now, 60 billion to, plus actually. So you can see that, new businesses are actually valued higher. And so if your own business is not renewing itself, has not acquired in companies from outside and brought those capabilities inside, brought those products inside, you are losing out actually. From market cap also. And if your market cap is below your competition, which is a new business, they will acquire you. These are important things that you need to think about. Let me go further. When you look at the current, situation with COVID and things like that, I want to highlight here is the appreciation of science and engineering has increased because our dependence on science, dependence on engineering has increased. Unprecedented collaboration between industry, academia, and government, global collaboration. The collaboration is digital, online. And the entire world is working to understand the virus, find cures, vaccines. It's amazing that we have 10 or 12 candidates today, vaccine candidates, all within the span of about 12 months since the virus really started spreading from last January, actually, which is almost 1/4 the time that it would have taken previously. The fastest a vaccine was brought to market was 4 years. Now we've got 10 vaccine candidates within a period of 1 year. This is also going to create a challenge for vaccinating 7 billion people. And largest number of non-peer-reviewed papers and peer-reviewed papers are published to date. So the speed at which science and engineering is happening today, how can we institutionalize this? How can we actually do this on an ongoing basis? Why should science and research be, or creation of new products and services be at the slow pace that it is taking today? This also requires regulatory authorities to work to improve the speed and things like that. The transition to digital, how the entire world, only part of the population, will accept that, transition to digital in such a very short period of time. And all when it is required we change rapidly. When there is no choice, we change rapidly. Again, you know, something that we need to think about actually. How can we internalize these things? How can we you know, adopt and adapt to these kind of changes and transitions faster? It will probably not you know, without mistakes, without errors and things like that, but we will learn to correct them if we increase the speed. So first point I want to make is the use of technology has increased, use of science has increased, appreciation has increased, and the speed also has increased by all stakeholders and participants, including the government. Government approval processes, government has removed you know, so many restrictions and things that in India, board meetings have to be physical. Otherwise, attendance would not be marked. Now we can be virtual. AGMs can be virtual. You know, banks should accept scan checks. Previously, they would not. It's become the de facto standard today. If you ask any business anywhere in the world today, if something can be done using a computer, and where would you do it? Most of the time, they would say India. Where would you want to do software work to be done? India. This has become the de facto model. You know, if you look around in Bangalore, if you look around in Chennai, if you look around in Hyderabad, you will see the R&D facilities of multinational corporations. They are second largest, third largest HR resource. In China, maybe 20th de facto model. The top, out of the top 10 companies in the world providing IT services, 5 are Indian today. So we have actually created a world-class industry in a lifetime and brought significant changes. Now, this was on top of the digital computing revolution. And look at you know, how much new technologies are actually in the horizon. I feel that the next 30 years are going to be even more exciting than the last 30 years. Even more exciting than the last 30 years. You know, with IoT and computing everywhere, with 5G coming in, you will have ubiquitous connectivity. The whole AR, VR, you know, the vision revolution that we have seen in front of us, cloud computing, which is providing invisible computing all around us. The fabric of computing is everywhere now. 3D printing, which can change manufacturing. AI and ML, it's a fundamental technology, and I'll talk about this. Where, you know, the whole area of genetics, code of life, biotech and things like that, better materials, whole area of data business. I won't go into details of this. I just want to illustrate why these things are fundamental and why it will change everything that we do through one example. I feel that every industry is going to change because of this. Every single industry will change because of this. Healthcare will change because of you know, wearable devices, connected appliances, telemedicine. We have already seen that happening now. Genomics will change healthcare, personalized medicine, robotic surgery. And the business model will also change, which becomes preventive and membership-based. Media entertainment, already you are seeing the changes with how we consume content on our personal devices in an asynchronous mode. That means, you know, the program is viewed asynchronously rather than live. So you have choices. It's interactive, shared experiences, financial services. India is, I believe, a leader here to the world in terms of you know, how the whole payment infrastructure has changed, the concept of account aggregators and things like that. During the COVID times, we see restaurants reimagining their businesses, looking at takeout services, home delivery, cooking lessons, delivering semi-cooked ingredients, digital customer interfaces and things like that, you know, contactless experiences in restaurants. Retail, of course, is changing. Manufacturing is changing. Transportation, we are looking at complete transformation of transportation, including ownership of automobiles and things like that. Hospitality, you know, look at the model of Airbnb, Ola, Oyo rooms and things like that, you know, asset light models, etc. Every single industry is transforming because of the technologies that I talked about. And this is a great opportunity for us actually. I will just touch upon one technology. I have slides on another, but I won't have time to take you through that. See, the digital computer revolution was about automating what we can do, what we know how to do. So if you can write an algorithm, feed it into the computer as a computer program, then feed in the data, the results will come out. But we need to know how to solve the problem. If we know how to solve the problem, we can use the power of computing, and the power is immense actually. You know, we can do maybe, the best of us can do 100 calculations per minute. A computer can do billions of calculations per minute. So we throw the power of the computing to actually do what we can do manually, and get better results, get amazing results actually. And this has transformed the world over the last 50 years, right? But look at what the paradigm is now. You actually train the computer. You don't need to know how to solve the problem. So you tell the computer, these are all pictures of faces, right? And you are able to then train the computer to recognize faces. And that's what now we are using. We are creating machines that when trained to solve problems, we don't need to know how to solve the problems. We just need to tell it, this is the desired result, and it figures out the algorithm. So the output of AI ML is the program, whereas the program was the input to the digital computing revolution. Here, we are now using the power of computing to solve problems. And it's a very different paradigm. And what happens because of that? A huge number of problems till now, which were unsolved, can now be solved. What I call the intelligence revolution. Speech recognition, real-time translation, intelligent personal assistance, surveillance possibilities, etc. Because you can recognize people, you can recognize things, self-driving cars, all of these things. And in the future, I believe that artificial intelligence will be possible. Humans don't replicate what nature does the same way. You know, we don't have flapping wings in our aeroplanes, right? It's fixed wings. Whereas all the birds we see flap their wings. We tried flapping wings. We figured out very quickly it don't work. So we created a new mechanism to do things. So when we replicate, we don't exactly replicate. If you look at arithmetic, how computers do arithmetic, it's not how we do arithmetic. We do arithmetic actually using pattern recognition. You know, remember how we learn multiplication tables and things like that. We are actually putting that in your memory, and it does pattern recognition actually. So a network of machines can be more intelligent than humans. Now, if you create an AI ML system for specific tasks, combine them together, I believe that we will be able to create systems that are more intelligent than humans in the near future, which is artificial general intelligence. And we are seeing that actually. Our mobile phones are becoming more and more intelligent. They know more about us than us do or family does. IoT, I won't go into that. I believe it's fundamental. From going from 5 billion connected computers to 50 to 60 billion, it'll transform the world. The whole data revolution, again, will transform the world. I want to conclude by saying that India opportunity is huge. And that is why I am very optimistic to say that in some sense, 20th century was US century, 21st century, we can make it to India century. You know, we are the second largest consumer base. We are a poor country, but we are growing very rapidly to become maybe a $20 trillion economy. Imagine from 2.7 trillion today to 20 trillion in the next 30, 40 years. And that's what the future holds for the students of today. That's your responsibility to make sure that India becomes a middle-income country, a middle-class country. And we will create several world-class companies and industries. Now, NASSCOM predicts that we will have 50 unicorns this year. You know, we are already the third largest ecosystem for startups. This will change India, and India will actually lead the world in certain things actually. And we have created our own model for development, which I hope will be a different model that other countries have created. More sustainable model, more equitable model, more inclusive model. And we are starting to create this base, actually. We have a large number of IT professionals. We continue to create scientists and engineers in large numbers. Till now, we are feeding the rest of the world, mainly to the US, but I think some of them will now stay back because there'll be opportunities to do research in India. There'll be opportunities for entrepreneurship in India. The incubators are very important. IIT Madras Research Park has championed this, but now I'm very glad that many other IITs are taking this forward. We have created a new education policy. We have increased spending on R&D and focus on lab to market processes, and industry is an important partner in this. And this is what I mean by India's model for development, which is more equitable, sustainable, inclusive. We need to create new models for our cities, how we live, livable cities and things like that. 21st century business and business models, you know, healthcare for all, regenerative agriculture, everything will change. And that is the opportunity for India, because when things change, new leadership can be created. So on the occasion of the launch of TechIn, I wanted to give you a context of how research is applied through creation of structures within the institute, how industry must partner. If industry does not partner, they're going to lose out. So I would, you know, request industry to partner in a big way, create internal benchmarks, internal goals to how this partner will benefit you and drive your leadership to truly take advantage of this. In the short term, we saw how our dependence on science and technology, digital, etc., have increased. But more importantly to me, the speed at which it has happened and why we can't use that speed. Then I talked about, you know, the opportunity that technology provides to create transformation, leadership, opportunity, and why I believe India is the place to take full advantage of this and emerge, you know, in the 21st century, that is in the next 30 to 40 years or 50 years, emerge as a world leader to create new businesses and new business models. So thank you all very much for giving me this opportunity to share my thoughts at this point. Thank you very much, and congratulations again.